And we are back on Big Board Sports. Roger Weiland with you at Giants training camp, along with Chris Honorato, and joined by Pat Leonard, Giants beat writer, New York Daily News, a good friend of the show last couple years. And Pat, good to see you as always, my friend. How you doing?
Great to see you too. You got some good real estate here. Beautiful blue skies looking over the practice fields here. An optimistic training camp here for the Giants after a forgettable year. But they're nothing and nothing now. They're 0-0. That's their record. No longer 3-13. And there's some talent out here on the field, you know. A couple of months ago, we didn't expect Odell Beckham to be out here. How was he going to look? He looks healthy. He looks great. Saquon Barkley looks great. And Eli Manning is preaching, you know, like he wants to have the best season of his career. So no reason not to think good things right now about the Giants.
Let's get to OBJ. What can you tell us about contract negotiations? Do you think he will get a new contract before the season kicks off in September?
I do think he will. You know, there was a report this morning on ESPN that the contract talks had started, as John Mara had said last week they would. Little interesting that yesterday on local radio, Mara said that it depends on how reasonable they are on whether it'll be done by week one. That makes you think, if they have begun and he's saying that, is he saying that the initial proposal was not reasonable, or is he not privy to that information? Have they not exchanged numbers yet? I will say this, you know, from the beginning with Odell, he wants to make a mark here. He wants to make a mark with all the metrics in his contract. So Antonio Brown has the highest salary in the NFL for a wide receiver annually. It's $17 million. Odell wants to supersede that. Mike Evans got $55 million guaranteed in March on his new contract in Tampa Bay. Odell wants more than that. You know, Odell also, not only does he want more, but he's owed more in the sense that, like, look at what Julio Jones is going through in Atlanta and other players like Aaron Rodgers as he comes up on his next contract. The NFL is doing so well that players at the top end are signing contracts, and a year and a half later, they look or feel like they're underpaid, because guys who get paid 6 months, a year after them, are getting more money. And if their stats, which is, this is what it's all about, comparables in pro sports. So when your comparables line up and dominate in other players and you're seeing him making more money than you, to the agents, to the players, that really matters to them. And for Beckham, it also matters. He wants guaranteed money. And that's where I think, if this does hit another snag here somewhere, once it's started, that's where they'll hit a snag. If he wants, say, a fully guaranteed contract, and even if he's willing to take a little less money for a fully guaranteed contract, will the Giants do that? Do they want to set the type of precedent that Kirk Cousins gets it in Minnesota, but that's a quarterback? That's a top free agent on the entire market in the league for a calendar year. Would they be willing to do that for a wide receiver? And what will Odell take? What will he accept? What is the lowest bar that he will accept? I do think this is not the end of it. I don't think just because they started, they're just going to wrap up the negotiations. But I think the Giants would be silly if they didn't get it done before week one, because I firmly believe Odell would not play if it wasn't done by then.
I'm in the camp that if I were him, and certainly he's not going to ask me my advice, but I wouldn't even play in a preseason game if I'm Odell Beckham Jr. without a new contract. He's out on the practice field, right? He looks good. Mm-hmm. He's showing the Giants he's healthy, can play football, ready to go. Why put yourself in a position without the guaranteed dollars in front of you that you may get injured again?
I totally agree with that. Yeah, we just saw last preseason in Cleveland he gets hurt, and that was the same ankle that he eventually breaks. Pat Shurmur, actually, I raised my eyebrows. I think it was at the NFL owners meetings in Orlando in the spring. Shurmur made a comment that he thought it was important that all players, even veterans, get some action in the preseason. And I'm going to come back to that with him here soon for this exact reason. Shurmur strikes me as a very pragmatic man and coach. I think he understands that Odell Beckham Jr. is not any other player on his roster. And I think he will handle him as such. What I wonder is if, let's say the Giants say to him, just like they did at mandatory minicamp, hey, we want you on the field for a little bit, and Odell has to say no. I think the Giants have to be smart enough, even if they want to see him in the preseason,
yes.
I think they have to be smart enough to not start that fight, because both of them have gotten this to a point now where we never thought it would be 3 or 4 months ago, where it sounds like they're both on the same page trying to get a deal done. But I just think any little fight, whether it's over preseason play, guaranteed money, whatever it is, could spark a fire that sends this going back the other direction.
Well, it sounds like you're in the corner that this will get done, though, by the start of the season. Right?
I do. And the main reason I think that is because even though the Giants have played, you know, have kind of tried to push Odell here to his limit, this entire offseason for New York has been about limiting the distractions and the circus that they've been going through the last couple of years.
Yep.
They've done it successfully in every other realm of this offseason, from the hiring of GM and Shermer, the players they brought in. I don't think they want to bring down that kind of drama and, you know, negativity on an otherwise optimistic year, especially when they draft Saquon Barkley. They're trying to win again now. They didn't draft a young quarterback and say, hey, stick with us for 3 years down the road. So I think all the optimism that's building, I don't think the Giants would risk that, and that is Beckham's greatest leverage, I think, is that he has to look at the Giants and say, you guys want to get this done too. Everyone's feeling great about this year after last year's 3-13. The last thing you want to do is, before you even win or lose a game, start with this kind of negativity. So that's a major reason why I think it gets done.
We talk all the time about the weapons that this team has. Heck, we did it last preseason as well, and then injuries hit them, obviously. If they're healthy, what is the reason this team doesn't get to the playoffs? Are there weaknesses? Do you have areas of concern on this roster?
I think my two biggest questions are cornerback depth. And Shermer was saying yesterday that in this defense, you know, you're really attacking the quarterback blitzes, but that puts corners on islands. You know, you want one-on-one coverage. And behind Apple and Jenkins, there's not a lot of certainty in the DBs. I mean, Landon Collins is great, strong safety, but there's a bunch of players competing for free safety. There isn't a sure starter right now. And then you have the, you know, William Gay at slot corner. You know, can he get the job done? Backups like B.W. Webb, Michael Thomas, Grant Haley, the undrafted rookie out of Penn State. You know, who's going to step up from that group? That's a big question for me. They released DRC, obviously, and there were financial reasons behind that. But he was a very versatile and valuable player. I mean, you guys know last year there were times where they had him at safety just because he walked. He's the kind of guy who wakes up in the morning, walks out of bed, and just could run like a 4.4 40. You know, this is DRC, and they don't have him on the roster anymore. The other thing is the offensive line. It could be a lot better than last year. It could be a little better than last year. We don't know, because if you think about it, there's all this talk about them upgrading. But Justin Pugh at left guard was a very good player. He's gone. Weston Richburg, very good center, is gone. So, yes, Solder is better than Flowers at left tackle. But do we know Will Hernandez this year is better than Justin Pugh was last year? Do we know that John Jalapio at center is better than Weston Richburg / Brett Jones were last year? I definitely think Patrick Omame, who they got from the Jaguars at right guard.
And he's got some experience.
Definitely has some experience. Was on a run-heavy team last year where they were leaning on him and that line successfully, I might add. And, you know, he's an upgrade over John Jerry, who is now a backup right now. And probably over DJ Fluker overall, though Fluker was a very good run blocker, just struggled in pass pro. And then Flowers, obviously, even though he's moving to right tackle here, remains a question mark. And also their depth is not great, especially at the tackle position. So it looks like a better line on paper than what they had last year. But that also was a very low bar to jump over, considering how poorly the line performed, especially Flowers at left tackle, Bobby Hart at right tackle last year. So that's my question, is how much better is that line? And will Saquon Barkley be running behind a very strong offensive line? Or will they be asking him to make something out of nothing? And will that be a recipe for success?
We're talking with Pat Leonard, New York Daily News. We're at Giants training camp here in East Rutherford, New Jersey, at Quest Diagnostic Center. One thing the Giants did make a point to throw out there at the very beginning of this with the draft is that they believe in Eli Manning, right? I mean, that's pretty clear that they think Eli can still get this job done for a couple of more years.
No question. Yeah, I mean, their support of him coming off of last season was staggering. Not surprising, though, considering, you know, when the benching happened and when the fans reacted the way they did. And I, you know, on the one hand, I thought they should have taken a look at other quarterbacks. On the other hand, I thought the way they handled Eli was the wrong way to go about it. It's almost like Ben McAdoo forgot that Eli Manning was different than every other person in this building for a lot of different reasons.
And people would have been more forgiving, Pat, if it were Webb, right?
Definitely.
And not Geno.
Definitely. And even, you know, even let's say that you give Geno some time just to put some snaps on tape, you know, so that when he hits free agency, he makes a case. But the idea that they didn't go to Webb at all in that game, and then that there was no clear drawn-up plan for it to happen, and then even though they were supposedly going to do it down the road, then they totally abandoned it. Yeah, exactly. I'll go where the Giants go with this, and let's not relive that disaster, right?
Yeah.
No, but Eli Manning showed a lot of struggles last year despite all the drop passes, but the Giants certainly believe he can get it done, and everything they've done on the offense as far as adding players has been to bulk up his weapons and his protection so he can get it done.
Barkley should have a phenomenal year. I don't see any reason why not. Well, no offensive
question.
Line.
The number one Giants question I get this offseason is, should I draft Saquon in the first round in my fantasy draft? And I say, I'm not going to tell you no.
Right.
You know, I mean, Eli was just talking yesterday about, he's looking forward to Saquon getting 25 carries in a game and see what he can do. So it's no secret they intend to give him the ball a lot. It's no secret that he's a very good receiver. And I actually think that we talk about it a lot, but I think that is the biggest deal. I think the biggest issue here is he's picking up the pass protection pretty well in practice, and if he can pass protect well as a rookie, he has the strength. It's just about recognitions and the plays. If he can do that, then you're not taking him off the field on plays, you know, on certain downs and distances. Now he's there, three down back, four down back, and he can become a weapon out of the backfield. Look at what Jerick McKinnon last year with Minnesota. Look at the contract he just got with San Francisco because of how Pat Shurmur used him and how much of a weapon he makes his running backs. And now you have a running back who he has been compared to Barry Sanders that Shurmur's working with. Sky's the limit for Barkley. A lot of pressure, but he's going to have a lot of opportunities too.
Pat, appreciate a few minutes. We love your work and love having you a part of this show from time to time. So have a great rest of training camp. And before we know it, it'll be week one of the NFL season.
Can't believe it's already here, but thanks for having me. Always a pleasure.
Thanks,
Roger,
buddy.
And Chris. Take care.
Thank you, Pat.